Hello viewers, welcome to another exciting episode of NGO Today. Today we'll be discussing about the challenges of running an effective NGO in Nigeria. Apparently, quite a number of NGOs have sprung up and they have died sudden deaths due to the challenges they faced. But we'll be having a guest speaker in the studios today to talk about the challenges of running an effective NGO. Joining me here is Mrs. Iwalola Akinjimo. She's an executive director of Ovieburume Foundation. She is a member of the Nutrition Society of Nigeria. She's also on the board of Youth Empowerment Foundation, and she's also on the board of Development Communications and Positive Action for Treatment. Welcome today. Thank you for joining us, ma'am.
Thank you.
Now, could you please tell us, what does it mean to run an NGO?
Well, to run a non-governmental organization in Nigeria, the first thing is that you need to have a cause. When I say a cause, it means that there's a problem or an issue that you have identified that is pertinent enough for you to actually invest your time and invest your resources. And a lot of NGOs spring up as a result of issues that are important but cannot be quantified. Ideally, an organization should be set up when you have a very important issue that affects the society, that affects development of the child, that affects the development of individuals. And so you don't just set up NGOs just for the fun of it, but for a cause, and it has to be unique. And you have to be able to do it differently. In case there are organizations that are already working in a particular area, you have to be able to do things in a different way that actually impacts your cause.
Okay, talking about the setup, what structure do we need to set up an effective NGO?
Now, in Nigeria, it's important for you to take a lot of legal issues into consideration. And when I mean legal issues, a lot of organizations are set up that don't have the backing of the legal structure or the backing of government. And so, if you want to set up a non-governmental organization in Nigeria, apart from the fact that you need to have a cause, you need to have the objective that you are working towards, in which case you can quantify the nature of the problem that you are trying to address. And the reason why it's important to quantify is because somewhere down the line, a year, 2 years down the line, you have to be able to show that you've actually impacted the cause for which you are set up. Now, the legal backing that I said before is that you have to be registered. Your registration can be at several levels. You can register at the local government level, you can register at the state level, you can register at the national level. Now, it's key actually to register with the agency of government called Corporate Affairs Commission. And you can either register under a setup that is for Board of Trustees, in which case you have a Board of Trustees, or in which case you're limited by your Board of Trustees. You can also be limited by guarantee. But for the setting up of these legal structures and for the registration process, you need to consult with qualified agencies, lawyers, who can actually help you not only easy, but also to make sure that you properly define the cause for which you're fighting. And you also, somewhere down the line, you are able to monitor. So the legal structures are key and very important for you to have before, not necessarily before your operations. You can start your operations, but you need to register as quickly as possible so that you can also access resources both within the state and outside of the state at the national level.
Okay, personally for me, I feel the role of NGOs in any nation do complement the role of the government as well when it comes to development. Do NGOs need governments to survive?
Non-governmental organizations don't need government to survive, and that's the truth. As a matter of fact, you find out that a lot of civil society organizations are set up to even monitor government itself, what they're doing and what they're supposed to deliver on. So sometimes civil society organizations adopt an activist role within the society. So you don't need government to survive. But in some situations, depending on what you're addressing, for example, let's take maternal and child nutrition as an example, as an illustration. You know, there are a lot of agencies of government that actually work on this. If, for example, you are working on maternal and child nutrition or child health in Nigeria, it's important for you to know what is going on within those government structures. And it's important for you to also know what gaps exist that can be filled by these government structures. It is important for you to know, you know, if there's a way by which you can complement what the government is doing, in which case you're managing your resources, you're using your resources to support government and also for the government to support you. So in some instances, depending on what you're addressing, it's important for you to work with government, it's important for you to complement the efforts of the government, because then you are maximizing the resources that are available, not only within government, even at the community level. So what I'm saying in effect is that for you to run an NGO effectively, you need to know what is going on, whether within government or outside of government or at the community level, depending on what you're addressing. But you don't need government to survive.
No. Does that mean government policies does not affect the role of NGOs and the way they work?
There are so many policies. It's when you talk about policies, it's a very broad area. There are policies governing the way civil society organizations are supposed to run, non-governmental organizations. There are certain agencies that are set up to track the activities of non-governmental organizations, depending on the area in which they work. There's so many networks that are set up by governments, by even bilateral bodies, by international agencies that are supposed to track the activities of non-governmental organizations. So that, for example, if you have an organization working on child protection as an illustration, and the organization is based there in Lagos and local governments, you might have an organization that's doing a similar thing on the Lagos mainland. It's important for these organizations to be able to network, share ideas, share problems, you know, support each other. And if there's a child protection issue that the organization here in Ejelsa finds out about Lagos mainland, it should be able to refer that same organization to address the issue. At the same time, there are referral setups within government that you might need to refer such a person to. So that's why I said, to a very large extent, policy is so broad. There are policies governing the way you respond to child protection issues. There are policies governing the way you respond to gender violence in Lagos State and even at the national level. There are acts that have been propagated that will address, for example, if a person living with HIV is stigmatized and is at the national level. So it pretty much depends on which area we're talking about. There's so many policies on education. There's policy about adolescent reproductive health. There are policies on maternal and child health. There's so many policies. So it's a very broad area. So there are policies, you know, that are guiding the way civil society organizations work. There's some agencies that you're supposed to register with. For example, you might need to register with EFCC. You might need to register with National Planning Commission if you need to get volunteers to come from outside of the country to work within your setup. So it's a very broad area. So of course, civil society organizations have to operate within those policies. Okay. You have to be law abiding, and you have to obey the rules and regulations of the country in which you are operating, which is in Nigeria.
Talking about volunteers coming from outside the country, what's the relationship between NGOs, take Niger for example, with NGOs from international communities?
Well, that's a broad area. Within organizations, civil society organizations, depending on the area in which you're working, let's say, for example, there's a civil society organization addressing public health issues. There are universities within Nigeria and outside of Nigeria that might be, that students are learning about public health. Civil society organizations provide facilities like an institution where such students can actually come in and learn more about fieldwork, learn more about how to address public health issues. So you have such relationships existing, and there's so many bilateral agencies and international organizations, even here in Nigeria, that coordinate efforts between you getting volunteers from abroad coming into your organization to work. But the truth is that a lot of times you have facilities where you can get technical volunteers. When I mean technical volunteers, volunteers who have skills in certain areas that you might be lacking within the organization, who can come into the country through these agencies to come and work for a period of 1 year, 2 years, it could even be less, it could be for 3 months, and you don't really incur a lot of cost to get them to come. Whereas if, for example, you're getting an international consultant to come to your organization to work, you pay through your notes. But these volunteers are available, you know, at minimal cost, and you can get them to come and work within the organization. So they're different, and there's so many organizations doing that. Even within Nigeria, there are organizations of young people, young graduates, who really don't have, who are not really paid employment, and they offer their services as a token, so that they can build up their resume, and they can have the prerequisite experience for them to actually get jobs. So there are so many opportunities for volunteering, both within and outside of the country.
I am aware that NGOs in Nigeria get a lot of support from NGOs abroad. Is it possible for NGOs in Nigeria to survive without the support of those abroad?
Well, I beg to correct you that not necessarily do all NGOs get a lot of resources from abroad. There are some civil society organizations who actually get all their resources from Nigeria. And there are some civil society organizations that are even attached to corporate organizations. So they get a certain percentage of the profit that such corporate organizations make and devote it to charity causes. So, in terms of that, there are organizations getting resources from different sources. It could be within Nigeria, it could be from UN organizations, it could be from different individuals. So definitely organizations can survive with the resources that are based within Nigeria. But you need to be creative and innovative about the way you get your funds. So you don't have, it's the government of Nigeria that still has the largest amount of resources for which a civil society organization can actually work. It's just that you need to be creative about how, you know, you access such resources and how you are able to couch your proposals in such a way by which you can access resources from individuals, you can access it from corporate organizations, you can access it from businesses, even small and medium scale organizations. What we're saying is, okay, how much do you need to run? How can you keep your overhead costs as low as possible? Can you use volunteers to deploy some of the activities that you want to deploy? Can you work in collaboration with faith-based organizations, churches and mosques, to tap into the resources they have to be able to deploy some of the programs? You also find a lot of faith-based organizations that are fully established who also have NGOs attached to them. They don't source for funds outside. They use resources from within those organizations to address whatever charitable cause that they have identified that needs to be addressed by the church or the mosque as case may be.
Okay. But does that mean that, I don't know, what's the rate of the NGOs, the local NGOs that get support from abroad and those that don't get in Nigeria today? What's the
rate? I can't say precisely, and I'm very wary of giving out statistics. But what one thing I can say for sure is the fact that there are a lot of resources within Nigeria for which organizations can tap into to work. And it's always better for organizations to operate in such a way that they don't depend solely on donors, whether individuals or corporate organizations or international events, to function. Because at some point, you cannot access resources forever. Now, at a point, a project will come to an end, or the donor decides that, you know, this is not the line in which I want to work. So it's very important for you as an organization to diversify your funding base and look at how you can, as much as possible, reduce your overhead costs and ensure that you can use local resources, community-based resources to implement your projects, use volunteer pools to implement your projects, and see if you can even have a business that sustains the activity of the civil society organization.
Okay. Let's look at competition here. Now, some NGOs out there, for me, I feel it creates unfair competition for local NGOs. Some NGOs abroad would probably feel more comfortable relating with governments in the local setting. Some NGOs would rather, looking at remuneration, they would rather, what we refer to as brain drain, they would rather take up personnel from local NGOs here probably giving them attractive remunerations, you know. Do competitions from NGOs abroad, does it affect the functions or the role of NGOs in Nigeria?
I think competition is good. you have to be able to do something different. You know, for you to excel in whichever field you have, find yourself, whether you are in civil society organization or you are even in the educational sector. So I personally feel that competition is good. And yes, indigenous NGOs have to compete with international NGOs to access funding. And there are many times when you don't have as much technical capacity as those international NGOs. But then at the same time, you have to look at how can you make your position more attractive to a donor. No matter how many international organizations are out there and they are being competitive with indigenous NGOs, indigenous NGOs have an edge because they know the terrain. And so you have to be able to market yourself in such a way that you are appreciated because you are on the ground. And to a very large extent, when you get people from outside of the country, you need to pay tickets, you need to house them. But if you work with indigenous organizations, you're using people who are fully on ground. And it's more sustainable because, like I said, it's not as if there's a continuous source of money that you're going to derive funds from. So when you have people who work with who are on the ground, it's more sustainable to work with them than to bring people from abroad. And a lot of international organizations are realizing this because even if they don't have the technical capacity, you can build their capacity. You can train them over a period of time, and they're going to remain here, really. So there's definitely competition. Competition is healthy, and I believe that that will also push a lot of indigenous organizations to go that extra mile to ensure that they have the technical capacity to implement it. But there are also opportunities for collaboration, I must say, which is very, very important. So even though you're based in Nigeria, you need to apply for grants. Maybe you don't meet the criteria in terms of how much grants you need to access before you can get that much grant. You can partner. You can identify an organization that has done work or that is currently doing work along that area. See if you have the same shared values, because it's very, very important. And explore an opportunity for partnership. So I strongly believe that if organizations adopt a partnership approach in the implementation of their projects, it's better because you can't be you can't be an island. If you can partner with another organization and see how you can harmonize resources between both organizations to implement your projects.
I was actually going there when it comes to partnership. I was going to ask you, what's the relationship between international NGOs and local NGOs?
There are a lot of partnership relationships. And there are also a lot of networks that exist at the international level that are also exist at the national level. And so they're honestly speaking, it's an area that is evolving, you know. It's an area that civil society organizations need to explore. And it provides an opportunity for you to also build the capacity of staff at this end, at the indigenous level. So I would say that civil society organizations should explore international partnerships. They should explore national partnerships. They should explore state partnerships in the implementation of their project. If, for example, a donor has called for, requested that you work, for example, in Lagos and Akwa Ibom and let's say Benue State, and you're here in Lagos State, you don't have to go and set up an office in Benue State or any other state. You can identify somebody that is doing similar work and find out if you share the same values and go ahead and access the funds and they do the work and where they are and you do your work where you are. Definitely there might be challenges, you know, but the truth of the matter is organizations don't need to have pockets or offices all over the country when there are organizations in those states that are doing similar work
like a partner
that you can partner with. Yes.
Now, let's look at a very important question here. I want to believe that no NGO can function without funding. Now, why do people feel, or why is generally believed, that funding is a major challenge when it comes to running an effective NGO, just the way it's a challenge to running a business venture?
there are scarce resources, and you operate in an environment where that's constant. That's the only, that's constant irrespective of which part of the world you are. When you go to the US, organizations there will tell you that they're having problems with money. When you come to Nigeria, anywhere you go to, funding is always a problem. But as mentioned in the chain, you have to look at creative ways by which you can implement your projects in such a way that you don't have too much overhead costs and you can use community-based resources and volunteers to deploy your activities. There's some areas where you can use volunteers in quotes because there's some, for example, if you have to do a medical mission, you definitely have to get qualified medical personnel to do those things. So it might not be very easy to access volunteers who have the necessary technical capacity to do that, even though there are organizations who provide some volunteers. But if, for example, you need to just clear a bridge, clearing a bridge does not need a lot of skills. I'm not sure there's anybody who doesn't know how to swim, as long as that person is above 10 to 12 years old. So you can imagine the number of volunteers you can access if all you need to do is clean up a bridge. So it depends on the areas in which you find yourself. Funding challenge is constant. It's what you have to live with, it's what you have to deal with. But then how can you diversify your funding base? Are there things that you can do within your organization to raise funds? Can you provide consultancy services in your area of expertise? Can you set up a small business that is like an SME attached to the organization that can generate resources for the organization? Do you have spaces within your organization that you can rent out and people can come in and use your space for seminars and workshops and you collect money? Can you do like sales of items that you don't need anymore to raise resources? So there are just so many ways. And a lot of people usually think that you need to talk to international organization or corporate organization before you can access resources. There might be individuals within your community that you can approach for some funding. It doesn't have to be huge, hundreds of thousands of naira, but something that can, you know, sustain, that can sustain a particular program or a particular child, a particular issue that you are trying to address. So funding will always be a challenge. It's something that a lot of civil society organizations have learned to live with, and that is why it's important for you to be creative, innovative, and do things in a different way. What makes you different from the other organization that is doing that same work? What makes you stand out? You know, what makes your project a must support project? So those are ways by which non-governmental organizations need to start thinking about.
Doing common things uncommonly.
Kind of.
Okay, now, while you were discussing about this, you mentioned volunteer. I'm getting confused here. This volunteer individuals, is it that they don't get paid, or is it that they don't get so much paid? I want to get clarification as to the issue of volunteer.
There are different volunteers.
Okay.
There are some volunteers that will come to your organization because they need to learn.
Okay.
And those ones, most times you don't pay them because they are also getting something.
Yes, from the,
they're getting things out of the organization. There are some volunteers that you need to give a token to because you're getting technical expertise in an area where you don't have the technical expertise. And so you might need to pay a token to those, maybe to cover costs for transportation. But it's important to identify organizations and agencies that provide the service so that you can establish links with them and see even if you qualify to get certain volunteers. Because there are usually criteria for accessing such volunteers. So some are paid, some are not. And it's always good for a non-governmental organization to have a volunteer recruitment program. You know, a way by which you get volunteers into your organizations to reduce your costs of operations.
And they are readily available at any time you
need. I'm not saying they are readily available. It's only when you start exploring that you know where to get them from. Yes, because for example, you might be situated in a highbrow area and you have children coming in to learn about maybe English and math, and you have so many banks around you, tell me, you can get volunteers from banks, you can get volunteers from even schools, private schools around you, who can come in to take some of those things. So you don't necessarily have to get a qualified teacher, as in, not that the people you are getting are not qualified, but what I'm saying is you don't need to pay that extra amount of money to get a teacher to come in to teach. If you can have a volunteer base and you have already a guide or a manual on how you want to do training for those children. So definitely, if you're getting volunteers from a bank, you don't need, the person is being paid already. The person is just devoting their time. So you have to make your volunteer program also interesting for you to be able to get people to come in and volunteer on a regular basis. And another thing is catching up very quickly within the corporate world, in the sense that now some corporate organizations make it mandatory for their workers to actually volunteer. So you need to know organizations that have this kind of
structure.
So that you can.
They've been paid up already.
Exactly. And they need to volunteer for them to go to the next level. Some people don't make it mandatory within the organization, but you know, they're just a huge pool of volunteers out there that you can tap into.
Well, that's a good one, anyway, because I mean, if companies make staff, they make them volunteer for services. I mean, that means indirectly making them give back to humanity.
Exactly.
You know, which makes a lot of sense.
Yes.
Now,
I want to ask, how are NGOs funded? How do they get funded? The sources of funding for NGOs.
NGOs get funded several ways. Let's look in words first. A non-governmental organization is supposed to have a board, whether board of directors or board of trustees. You can tap into your pool of trustees or directors to get certain resources from them that can contribute to whatever programs you're doing. And sometimes it doesn't have to be to do with money. It might just have to do with the contacts, their connections, for you to be able to access resources from other people. Because most times when organizations are set up, you're supposed to have a board that is slightly influential that can make you access resources, whether it's at the community level or at the national level or at the international level. So you can get resources directly from the board. You can get resources from so many other ways I've explained the other time. You can raise resources through consultancies. You can raise resources through volunteers. You might have volunteers that their role is to
just provide get, services.
Not just even provide services, to raise funds for you.
Oh, you see.
Yes, you can get volunteers to raise funds for you. You can also get, you can access resources from state governments, from faith-based organizations, which is a place that a lot of us don't look into. You can get from community-based organizations, because it's not just about money. Sometimes it's just a space for you to train. It might be a space for you to conduct a sporting activity. Or a point where they need to access health services. So it's diverse. But when it comes to direct funding, you can approach bilateral organizations, international organizations, UN organizations, you can approach corporate organizations, you can approach people's SMEs for funding. So it's really diverse. Yes, but the key thing is that you need to have a strategic focus. What are you doing? You know, I've mentioned it a couple of times. What makes you different? How do you do your things differently that makes you stand out, that makes your project a project that should be supported and funded? But one thing I always talk about is the fact that even if you're doing a project and you're accessing funding now, how do you make that project sustainable? In which case, when donor funds run out, what happens? Do you just close shop? And that's the end of a very successful project. What can you do to make it sustainable? How can you use community resources to make such projects sustainable? Some people are of the opinion that NGOs are not sustainable because every time you go cap in hand begging. But the truth is, you don't have to go cap in hand begging. If you start reorientating your mind to making your NGO not to be too dependent on resources from outside, but dependent on resources from inside. So how can you generate resources from inside that can make your organization sustainable?